Just before I start this video, I just want to talk about the music that you heard in the introduction. It's actually a tune called Ye Hypocrite, Ye Beelzebub, I think that's how you say it, which was composed by George Russell and is on his Jazz Workshop album. If you listen to my version, though, it doesn't sound like George Russell's. George Russell's is like this. See, what it is, what you're hearing there is like two part counterpoint in a way. I know you've got the trumpet player playing a riff and then saxophones playing out top. It's like two lines that are competing with each other. What I did is I also took the end of the tune, which is they basically play again, but they kind of like playing against each other, against that melody they play at the beginning. And I put that over the top so it becomes more complicated. So it's like a bit like four part counterpoint. Now, I did that because I was just interested, because Hal Galper says that you can't hear more than one line through. It's the melodic line and you've got to harmonise around it. And I just wanted to show you that that was four-part harmony at the beginning. And how bad was it? Nobody's actually complained and said that's a load of rubbish you're playing. You know, it's all in harmony, so you're actually hearing the way the chords are moving. But nobody complained about it, so you've got to like question things like, does music have to be a single line going through, or can it be chords? You know, are people interested in listening to just the chords or counterpoint? You know what I mean? So, and counterpoint does go back hundreds of years. So I thought I'd just stick that in as a little bit of an interest here. I also did it because I didn't want to get copyright. By doing that, it's kind of like makes it a unique tune, and I don't actually get copyright things coming back at me on it. Okay. I'll probably get copyright on that I've just played, actually. Right, I just want to go back to this chart that we were looking at in the last exciting episode of Lydian Chromatic Concept. What it is I've actually figured out what this means now. When I talked about last week, I've actually shown you, it says constant nucleus. These are supposed to be the scales in the constant nucleus. Then we've got these other scales here. And I said I couldn't figure out what this nine tone is, because there's no Lydian chromatic scale built like this, or one that's built on 11 tone. And I actually understand what it means now. It isn't a Lydian chromatic scale. I don't understand why he's actually put it in here, but I understand what it is now. What it is this, just to say. Right, what it means is, it means a nine-tone scale built on all these notes. So nine-tone means nine-tone order. All those notes there, if you make a scale out on it, that's what you get on the chart. And when he says 11-tone, what he means is 11-tone orders. Order, right? It's not the auxiliary diminished, which you see there, and it's not here, the Lydian diminished. What it is, it's all those notes. Remember, the Lydian diminished is using all those notes up to there, but not the C, the G sharp. But this nine-tone order scale is put in means all those notes. And it's same here with 11-tone note. It's not the auxiliary diminished scale. What it is all the notes. If you make a scale up with all those notes, that's what you get in that chart. That's what you get, and these are the intervals that you can create, you know what I mean, using that. Now, Russell obviously kind of like thought it's not a good idea, this, after a bit, so he dropped it, and all we get now in the modern one is the scales of the Lydian chromatic order, and we don't get these nine-tone things or 11-tone, but it's interesting to see what that is. Now I actually understand what it means. Also, one other thing as well. Okay, so also this tune that I put in, this Just Friends, this chord's wrong, which is written down. It's playing right, but it's playing wrong. That is not a flat nine; it's a ninth. In the Lydian chromatic concept, the chord is actually written down. If you've got a sharp 11, it's a ninth, right? So I actually wrote the chord down there, but I'm messing about that much trying to put this chord actually in as it should be written. That I actually put a flat in there, right? I was thinking too much about the other bit I've been talking about earlier, but it should be a ninth of that. So really, it should just say E flat 7 sharp 11 sharp 5, okay, like it does in the Lydian chromatic book. Or augmented chord would be better, but you can't actually put that in Sibelius. Okay, so that's that bit. So what we're going to do today, I'm just going to finish off this table that I did. Okay, so now we're looking at the Lydian flat 7 scale. Right, in mode 1, it would be F7, that would be the chord, the acoustic scale, which is basically this scale, the Lydian dominant. So basically that chord there and that scale, they're basically exactly the same. You're much more likely to use this, the Lydian, the Lydian dominant second mode, because it just works better with the way the Lydian chromatic concept works, that all seventh chords are basically on mode 2. This one here, G7 sharp 5, basically everything that's in blue has got no avoid notes. It don't really have any avoid notes, because if you look at the scale, G, B, E flat, which is D sharp, the sharp 5, and then F, which is the scale. You've got the A, which is above the G, which is okay. You've got a D, so you don't have to put that C there. You can put the D, so you can have like a new 11th type thing, and that's okay, because it's more than a half step above that B. And then you've got the F, which is, but you know, it actually works, that scale, G7 sharp 5. Just get rid of this. Right, this one here, B minor 7 flat 5, is also the alter scale. Remember when I was talking earlier on about substitute dominance, right? People say if you got something like a B alt chord, you use the melodic minor scale half step up, so that would be C melodic minor. If you take the seventh mode of C melodic minor, right, that's the scale you get, B minor 7, that's the chord you get on it, B minor 7 flat 5, right? If you use the scale of the melodic minor, C melodic minor, it's the same as the scale on B alt, right? So in B alt, there's no avoid notes, but on that B minor 7 flat 5, look, you've got to watch out, because B, look, you've got a C, which is a half step, and B, D, you've got the C that's above the root, B, and you've got the E flat above the D, which would be the third, so you've got to watch out with that. You've got to play avoid notes with that one, so I've put it there. I'll let you study it. I'm not going to start filming. But on the altered, you don't. D minor 7 flat, flat 9, which you can build up from that scale. Obviously, the E flat's the flat 9. That's okay. There's no avoid notes there. So it's quite good that you can get like four type of chords without any avoid notes, can't you? So you can really play a Lydian on that one. So have a look at the whole tone and see what that's about. Okay, so I'm looking at the whole tone scale. You can play it on, in mode 1, you can play it on an F augmented triad with no avoid notes. It plays okay. The main one, though, is this on mode 2. It's basically a G7 chord. We have a short 5 or a flat 5, and you don't get any avoid notes whatsoever. Obviously, it's like I said earlier, a whole tone scale is symmetrical. All these scales from now on are basically symmetrical, apart from blues. And therefore, there's no avoid notes. You know, well, not saying there's no avoid notes. I'm just saying you can't produce modes with them. Because if you play the chord from G, you end up getting one of, you know, this scale. It just carries on forever and ever and ever. You just keep getting the same scale all the time. It basically fits on chord 2, on mode 2. All mode 2s are basically 7th chords, aren't they? So that's where you normally see it, part of this genre. So it basically works on G7 short 5 or G7 flat 5 on this scale, the F whole tone scale, and there's no avoid notes. We don't get a sharp five in major, so we put it down here on a sharp five, and here it becomes D flat seven sharp five, D flat seven flat five. You know what I mean? But it's always going to produce those chords because it's a symmetrical scale. So that's an interesting one for you to look at. So let's move on to the whole half diminished scale now. Okay, so this is the diminished scale, whole half diminished, right, written down there. You can play that scale over F diminished 7, so in mode 1, and it plays without any avoid notes. And when it gets to mode 2, you can play over G7 flat 9 without any avoid notes. Remember that tensions are one tone above each chord tone. So when you work the chord out, it's a scale as a note that's a whole tone above, then you're all right. This, it can play a G7 flat 9, but when you play this G7 flat 5, which you can also form, you do get, see, that's the flat 5, that C sharp. You get that D within the scale, which is half step above that. You know what I mean? You've got G7 flat 5, you wouldn't play the fifth normally, would you? So that would be out, so it's kind of like half an avoid note, you know what I mean? So I've put it down as not a perfect scale. But I think if you played it on beat and then just resolved quick, you'd be all right. You've got D7 here, sharp 9, and D7 flat 7, sharp 5 on mode 5, sharp 5. And if you look at that, you'll see that there's a flat 9 distance. But the thing is, when you play sharp 5, you can also play a flat 9. That's one of the rules of harmony on seventh chords. So basically I'd say that they were okay, but it's up to you. I'm only guiding you through this. I'm just showing you my way of doing this table. I mean, you can make this table up as you want, or you can follow what I'm doing. I'm looking at chords that are not repeating themselves and quickest way to get to them, you know what I mean, and the most interesting sounds. So let's have a look at the half whole diminished now. Okay, over half diminished, you can play on mode plus 4, B minor 7 flat 5, and on mode 6, you can play D minor 7, D minor 7 flat 5. They're going to have avoid notes, those, if you look at that scale, because on diminished scales, all tensions are one tone above a chord tone, right? And if you look, there's half steps above, so you've got to watch out on those. This one here, the blues, you can play on all sorts of seventh chords mainly. You could play on a sixth chord as well. I put sixth chord down because you've got a D there. So you could work it on a sixth chord if you wanted. But basically, I'm sure you all know how to play on a blues. Okay, so that's it. I've just put in at bottom on seven because I didn't write out in. These are George Russell's versions of these scales. Like I said, I don't think they work that as good. You see, you've got E7 flat 9, but if you look at that, EG, where are we? EG, G's a flat third, isn't it? So that bit's more like minor, you know what I mean? So if you're playing that, you could play it actually. I know I criticised this before and said it should be minor, but you could actually play it to give you a bluesy sound because you're playing a flat third. So I don't know, I suppose they do work like he says. You're just making more different sounds, aren't you? And we are going out, aren't we? You know what I mean? So let's go back to that chart that I did a couple of videos ago where I was telling you about the problems of the Lydian chromatic concept, okay? Okay, so this is from video 8 of my series. If you remember, I said that there was basically three problems: style, complexity, analysis. The style, which is how the music, how you play, is basically something you have to solve yourself. You listen to the music you love, get into the style of it, and then use the Lydian chromatic concept to help you determine what notes you're going to play within that style. If you're like playing New Orleans type music, you would the table that I showed you would be very simple, wouldn't it? You know what I mean? So you can reduce the complexity of the Lydian chromatic concept down to a simple table which you can use. I think the Lydian chromatic concept works best though in complicated music, because you can adapt that table to your own music. So that's a way of reducing the complexity using the table within the style that you're using. Now, the most interesting thing I think about this is the analysis. Now, if we go to the Lydian chromatic concept and look how George Russell analyses tunes. If you look at this, look, Giant Steps, John Coltrane's famous solo. just look at this. We've got this scope chords, and he's changed to D. He's telling you what scale it is, and I suppose this means the mode. C Lydian mode 2, because it's D7, mode 1. But you're not really seeing the voice leading to me, how that's going through. And now the music's getting more complicated. And who the hell wants to look at a piece of music? We've got all this Lydian and all this kind of stuff written at the top. It just looks horrible. Now, since George Russell's time, there's been a new form of theory applied to music, which is based on set theory, which is called transformation theory, right? And transformation theory can simplify this, and actually you can see more in the music, and it really tells you, without having to write down and specifically, oh, this is C Lydian, it basically tells you very quickly. Now, you've got to get into the shorthand method of reading transformation theory on a page, right? But the Lydian chromatic concept does lead itself to transformation theory, and that is because, like I said in earlier videos of this, you don't get the cardinality problem you get with the Berkeley method. The Berkeley method is just one scale that attached to one chord scale theory, like Al Galper said, you know, you've got a fixed system. Whereas Lydian chromatic concept's not like that. It uses the complete chromatic scale, right? All the notes of the chromatic scale within any chord, so you can change the scales against the certain chords, you know what I mean? Or change the chords, you know what I mean? Make yourself more complicated chords. And showing the way it's going in like three dimensions, if you know, transformation can do that. So when you, if you like composing a tune, or even composing a solo, you're saying you're working on a solo yourself, and you want to add something off, you can just write in how the music is transforming. It's nowhere near as difficult, this, as people have put on YouTube. If you've seen any videos on transformation theory on YouTube, it's very, very, it looks very, very complicated. And it's because a lot of the people who are talking about transformation theory are super intelligent. I mean, like Franz Abers, who I've actually had some lessons off him myself. I bought a book on the ranging off him. He's super clever, but he hasn't got many subscribers, and the only people who are watching his videos are people who are really into that, you know what I mean? For the rest of us, it's just too mathematical, and it's just too crazy, you know what I mean? We don't want to get into that, we want to get into fun. Now, transformation theory, if you look at it in a very simple way, it is easy to see what's happening, and it does help you. I think it does help you, you know, it is a good thing. It's just the people who are doing it are really into classical music, and they're doing it from a classical point of view, and they're going into really heavy complexity, which you don't really need to go into that in jazz, I don't think. Well, you can do it if you want, but you know what I mean? So what I'm going to do is, I was thinking about actually teaching a bit of transformation theory to get you up, but I don't really think I have to. I think in the next episode I can basically just show you the basics, just so you can follow the music. And then it's up to you to decide whether you're going to use that or not. So this is basically the next video, the penultimate video. There's only two more videos which you can see my head in this. I'll be talking about transformation theory. So we're finishing that little thing, this off. So I'll be finishing this little analysis thing off. We will know about style and how to simplify it and how to analyse tunes. And then in the last video, right, I will just be talking about George Russell. Because all these videos are supposed to be a critical analysis, and it's ended up becoming like a teaching thing, you know, and it weren't meant to be that. It was only meant to be one or two videos, and I've just gone on and on and on and can't stop. So the next one will be transformation theory, and the last one I will be talking about my views of George Russell and what my criticism of the Lydian chromatic concept is, and what, you know, my conclusions are of it. And then I'll just finish off and tell you what happened to George Russell after 1953. Because in the first one, I gave a biography up to 1953. So just telling you what was around at that time when the Lydian chromatic concept came out. It's actually years in front of its time, really, as a concept of music. It's not been really accepted because Russell puts it all down to Lydian tonal gravity in that, you know what I mean? Everything's around the Lydian concept of tonal organisation. People a lot of academics start reading and just dismiss it. Like Adam Neely, if you see it at the beginning, Adam Neely, he's got all these weird theories, you know, and then we're not accepting it, you know. But actually, I don't think it's as complicated as people say. I think it's just written complicated, you know what I mean? That is one of my criticisms of Russell, which I'll be talking about in the last video, and other things as well. And then I'll just tell, like I said, I'll just tell you what happened to George Russell after that, just kind of finish the biography off. A bit briefer, though, because what I'm more interested in is how you lead up to writing something like this, what his life was up to leading up to it, you see. So that will be in the last one. So that's what's coming. So I'll see you later on. Bye.